Let's go.
So you have this one, right? And it's working?
Yes.
Sweet. All right, let's go with this for now. And we'll put this in the middle here. And then this one will just be eye candy. And we'll find out first and foremost if he has a second person, because usually he can't get a second guy for the closing.
Well, welcome to Bentry Online. I'm really excited for us to get to worship together. And I'm really excited because I've invited my friend Michelle to join in with us online. Thanks
Hello,
for joining.
Hello, friends. Hi.
You may recognize Michelle. She's been around a while, and she was on in the service last week. And we've invited her again because you talked about Make a Difference lunch.
I did. So we are having our Make a Difference luncheon today at Bentry after second service. And if you're close by and would like to join us, we would love to see you. You can just come and show up. We will have food for you. And the heart behind this luncheon is really for people to find out all the ways they can step in and make a difference here at Bentry and around the world. So each staff and ministry will be represented, and we're looking forward to just connecting people with opportunities to make a difference and experience the love of Jesus while they're serving.
It's pretty crazy. I was looking at the list. There's a lot of opportunities available because it takes a lot, not just for Sundays to happen, but actually for ministry to happen throughout the week and for things to happen just around here. So there's a whole lot available.
Yeah.
There's also, we have a couple roles specifically for people who maybe don't live close to Carrollton, who would want to, if you're joining in and you've been joining in for a while and you're thinking about being more connected to Bentry, I'd love to help you. And you don't have to come to the lunch to find out more. You can email me at online@bentry.org and I can help you with that. I will also put a link in the chat to all of the serving opportunities. Even if you can't make it to the lunch, you can check that out and see what's available. As we continue in this service, we are going to be in week two of our series, The Seven Signs. And this is looking at the seven signs that Jesus performed in the book of John. And today we have a treat. We get to hear from our worship and arts pastor, Caleb Willis, where he will be talking instead of singing. Although I did ask if he could sing his message to us, I think it would be beautiful for all of us to enjoy.
I agree.
That's my favorite part of the day when he sings.
Yes.
Whether we're in a service or in meetings.
Yes.
We get to worship together. We're going to open God's word and see the second sign that John wrote about, this beautiful healing that he did. And I can't wait to see what God has in store for us. So let's go into the worship center and worship together.
Take you and your your grace is always enough. You said your heart would never forget or forsake me. Let's declare those truths this morning. You said I'm saved. You call me yours. You said my future's full of your heart.
With you this morning, Bentry. My name is Jillian Landman. I am the worship and arts coordinator here, and we are really excited that you're here worshiping with us. And I have had the wonderful opportunity of studying in this book called Body of Praise, which, as someone who loves worship, I love reading about it. And this has been really unique because it talks about the role of our physical bodies in worship. I think usually worship can be something we think of as just being a spiritual or mental or emotional experience. But here he's really exploring that part of being created in the image of God means that our bodies also have a role in our worship. And he talks about this unification of heart, mind, and soul when we worship. And he says, there's no body doing one thing and soul doing another separate thing. There is only our whole humanity created and called to worship God with all of our heart, mind, and strength in our own unique creaturely ways. I love that. He's essentially saying that there's no part of us that doesn't come to Jesus when we come to worship him. It's every bit of us saying, Lord, you've created me, you have called me, you've anointed me as your son and daughter to worship you with all of my fullness. And we're going to have the opportunity to learn and hear a story as we continue in our series of the seven signs of Jesus, of a man who walks with his body, a physical act of his faith, a physical act of worship. And we can be reminded of that this morning as we continue to worship together, mind, body, and soul. Let's sing.
Stop working. You never stop working. 'Cause faithful you are. And faithful forever you will be. And faithful you are. We believe it this morning. And let's declare that together. Faithful you are.
so sweet to sing your name and to be able to say that I know that you satisfy, you alone, Lord. None other besides you. You are my shepherd, I shall not want. You are my shepherd, I shall not be in need. Jesus, our fullness of satisfaction is found in you. We love you, Lord. We praise you. Amen. You can be seated.
My name is Jessica Schaller, and I am the kids pastor here, and it is just a joy to be worshiping with you this morning. If you are new here, whether you are in the room or online, we just want to welcome you. Immediately after this service, we'll have a guest reception, and whether it's your first Sunday or whether you've been coming for a few weeks now and just want to learn more, we'd love to invite you to join us. It's going to be immediately out in the lobby over to the left, and we'll have some pastors and volunteers there that can just share a little bit about Bent Tree. At Bent Tree, we exist to experience and share the love of Jesus. And one of the things that's been really encouraging to me over the last few weeks is getting to meet so many new families that have been invited by you. I love hearing how the Holy Spirit is leading you to have those spiritual conversations and to invite people here. So keep sharing those stories with us. It really is encouraging. Well, if you're one of the people that's called Bent Tree home for a while and you're trying to discern what your next step is, we would love to invite you to come to a lunch after church today where we're going to be sharing some serving opportunities. Maybe you are ready to make a difference by serving, but in a church this size, it can be a little hard to know what all those opportunities are. So we're going to have a lunch. You can come and learn. We've got opportunities on Sunday morning and during the week. All of our ministry teams are going to be there to share that with you. So it is not too late to register. It is going to be after our second service, so you can just go home for a little bit, come back at 12:15. If you scan that QR code on the seat back in front of you, that has the registration link, so you can let us know you plan to attend. And we really hope to see some of you there. Well, coming up in June, I know that sounds a long way off, but for those of the moms and dads in the room, we know it's coming, right? So at the end of June, we have Fine Arts Day Camp. Can I get a show of hands if you've ever been a part of Fine Arts Day Camp before? Yes. All right. Well, if you haven't been at Bent Tree long, you may not know that this will be our 24th summer to put on Fine Arts Day Camp. Really is one of my favorite weeks of the whole summer. You may also not know that our very own Caleb Willis really honed his artistic gifts on a very different stage at Fine Arts Day Camp. I think I've got some photo evidence to prove from 2016. Yep, that is Caleb Willis. The last time we did Not Your Average Joe, which is the musical we're going to be putting together with the kids this summer. You know, I tried to convince him to wear those boots when he comes to preach this morning, but I'm not sure if he took the bait on that one or not. So, but really, there's two things that I love about getting to help lead Fine Arts Day Camp. And one is it really is a volunteer-led camp. We literally have hundreds of people, students, parents, grandparents. Sometimes they even take time off of work to get to invest in the faith of the next generation because we want these kids to experience the love of Jesus. So if you've never served, but maybe you've got the margin this summer to spend some time working with kids, we've got roles that are behind the scenes and with kids, we'd love to invite you to learn more about that. We're going to have a table out in the lobby with more details about how you can serve. Another thing that I just love about Fine Arts Day Camp is that it really is an opportunity to pursue our community. So I guarantee you, everyone in this room knows someone in either kindergarten up through fifth grade, right? And this is a great way to invite your friends, invite your neighbors, invite their kids to come be a part of camp. They may not say yes to a Sunday morning invitation, but man, they're looking for something fun for their kids to do come the end of June, right? So we've got some rave cards out of the table in the lobby that you can grab. If you're looking for a way to invite a neighbor or a friend to come join us for Fine Arts Day Camp, we would love to really fill up the whole camp with lots of kids. They're going to get to hear the gospel, and then on Friday night, they perform a musical where their parents will get to come also hear the gospel. So it really is a sweet opportunity for our families. So next Sunday, we have baptisms. And if you're just ready to take that next step of making a public profession of your faith, we want to invite you to be a part of our baptisms. They'll be at both the 9 and the 11 o'clock service. We do need you to register today so that we can get you all the details and make sure you're ready to go for those baptisms. So I'm really excited to see those testimonies and stories of how God is moving here at Bentree. So last Sunday, a couple of people snuck back into some areas behind the scenes to talk to some of our leaders about why they choose to serve and why they're making a difference. Let's check it out together.
So we're here on a Sunday morning at Bentree, and it takes hundreds of servants around this building to make things happen for our 9 a.m. and our 11 a.m. services. And so we thought we'd take a little bit of time today and talk to some of the servants that make days like today possible. Let's go talk to some people. All right, can you introduce yourself and tell us where you're serving this morning?
Hi, I'm Jeff Thurston, and I'm serving as the video engineer.
My name is Katie Query. I'm the senior, and I'm serving as a third grade small group leader.
I'm Rick Lavin, and I serve here on the kids' safety team.
Why do you serve in this specific role on Sundays?
I still remember the songs that I grew up with singing when I was in Sunday school, and so it's fun to teach the next generation of kids songs that I know will stick with them.
I just really love worship and getting to do it alongside everyone on our worship team.
I've always been called to serve with kids. I love being able to try to set some type of example for them, and honestly, it's just where I think God has been calling me.
This was actually when I volunteered. This is where they decided to put me.
Just trying to give back to the church and just help kids grow up with the foundation of knowing Jesus.
I think it's good to set an example of serving alongside our kids.
I love serving because I'm showing kids the ways of Jesus and how to be kind and loving and share.
Mason, why are you choosing to serve in kids' ministry each morning?
It's the only place they'd let me serve.
The only place they'd let him serve. That's amazing. Hey, good morning, church. My name is Caleb. I'm the worship and arts pastor here at Bentree. So grateful that you would take some time to gather, to worship, to open the word, and to be with Jesus with us this morning. I love seeing the video of everyone getting a chance to serve. Some of my earliest serving memories was back probably almost 2 decades ago now when our family moved here and we got plugged into Fine Arts Day Camp. My brothers were all campers and got to be junior counselors. What I love about Fine Arts Day Camp that is so unique is that we get to look hundreds of kids in the eyes that entire week. Some of them know Jesus, some of them don't, and tell them that every time they choose to express their creativity, they are expressing the imago Dei of God in them. Before we learn anything about God, before he ever speaks a word in scripture, before we meet any characters, before we understand how his grace will meet us, the very first thing we learn about God is that he is a God who creates. So when we invite students in to be a part of Fine Arts Day Camp, we're inviting them into the bigger picture of who Jesus is and the imago Dei that they have of Jesus in them. So I love Fine Arts Day Camp. We are in week 2 of the 7 signs of Jesus according to the Gospel of John. Last week we studied Jesus turning water into wine in Cana, and this morning we're gonna study the healing of the royal official's son in John chapter 4. Would love if you're comfortable to stand, and I'm gonna read the word of the Lord over us this morning. This is John chapter 4, beginning in verse 46. He went again to Cana of Galilee, where he had turned the water into wine. There was a certain royal official whose son was ill at Capernaum. When this man heard that Jesus had come from Judea into Galilee, he went to him and pleaded with him to come down and to heal his son, since he was about to die. Jesus told him, "Unless you people see signs and wonders, you will not believe." "Sir," the official said to him, "come down before my boy dies." "Go," Jesus told him, "your son will live." The man believed what Jesus said to him and departed. While he was still going down, his servants met him, saying that this boy was alive. He asked them at what time he got better. "Yesterday at 1 p.m, the fever left him," they answered. The father realized this was the very hour at which Jesus had told him, "Your son will live." So he himself believed, along with his whole household. Now this was the second sign Jesus performed after he came from Judea to Galilee. This is the word of the Lord this morning. You may be seated. Full disclosure, any time that we talk about healing in the church, it can be really challenging. We at Bentry believe that Jesus is still healing. He is still doing miracles, and we believe that he doesn't always do them. And we're not always sure as to the rhyme or reason why it did or it didn't happen. This can really quickly lead us into a few camps of lived experiences. I know for a fact there are people in this room this morning, and this has been my family's story and journey as well, who have begged God to intervene, to show up, and to do something miraculous, and it never came to fruition. And so in the anger and the frustration and then the disappointment of your lived experience, the temptation can very quickly be to lower the expectancy of what God is capable of. To maybe lower and diminish the hope, the anticipation that we have of who Jesus is, what he's capable of. Maybe we lower our bar a little bit because we don't want to set our prayer lives up for any sort of disappointment. We only want to ask spiritual prayers and questions that we're confident are checks that the Lord can cash. And so we lower our bar a little bit of what we're willing to bring to him. There's a second camp of people, which is like a totally different experience, where you have begged God to show up in a miraculous way and intervene, and he did. And so you're standing on the faithfulness of God and the evidence and his providence in your life, and the temptation there can be really easy too, for us to elevate not just the expectancy with which we live and interact with God of who he is and what he's capable of, but marrying that with an expectation that because you saw him do it once, he's for sure got to do it again now. We've seen him show up in our lives, so he has to show up. And we stop thinking about who God is and what he's capable of, and we begin to hover around when and why and where he should do something. And then there's this third camp of people, which is like all along that spectrum between those first two camps. Maybe you don't believe that God's in the business of healing because you haven't seen it yourself. And if you haven't seen it, probably nobody else has, right? Or maybe you feel like you've seen it, but in retrospect, you look back at the situation and something was weird about the circumstance, and you're kind of doubting its legitimacy for a little bit. Regardless of where you sit this morning as we talk about healing, I think everyone in this room can agree that it's really easy for our lived experiences to shape our theology. Our lived experiences can very easily influence and inform how these two things are interwoven with one another, living with an expectancy, with a hope, with an anticipation that God's gonna show up because he is who he says he is and he does what he says he'll do, but then also marrying it with the expectations that we have of him, of this is what I want it to look like. This is what I hope it looks like. In this second sign in John, we see a man approach Jesus out of sheer desperation, where he approaches him and he's just thinking, this is a miracle worker I've heard about. He's done this in Cana before. Let me find him and get him to do it again. And so a man who shows up asking for a miraculous to happen walks away with a relationship with the living Messiah. Jesus does this act in the latter part of John chapter 4, but he actually alludes to his ability to do this back in John chapter 3. And what's widely now considered is one of the most popular passages in all of Scripture. This is John 3, 16 and 17. For God loved the world in this way. He gave his one and only Son, so that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. A few verses after this, Jesus is at a well and he asks a Samaritan woman to draw him some water. And then he makes a weird comment that he is the living and eternal water. And after this really long dialogue and intercourse between the two of them, she realizes that she's not talking to a man named Jesus, she's talking to a Messiah. So she drops her water bucket. I love that symbolism. She showed up asking for physical water, seeking physical water. He says, I'm eternal water. Anyone who drinks of me will never thirst again. She drops her bucket because she recognizes who Jesus is. She runs back to the town. She sprints back. What does she tell the town? Come and see the man who's told me everything I've ever done. And the way that passage ends is by telling us that many people came to faith in Jesus because of this woman's testimony. And now we see the royal official in his story. So this happens on the heels of the Samaritan woman and her story. And the first thing that we learn about this man who's interacting with Jesus is that he is a royal official. Now, we can't be 100% confident, but most theologians are pretty confident that this man was a Gentile who served under King Herod's rule and authority. So we are now seeing two straight stories in Scripture where Jesus is having one-on-one interaction with non-Jews, and it leads them and the groups of people around them to salvation in him. It's just symbolizing that the gospel that Jesus is bringing would be for all people. Caroline Lewis, in her commentary, put it this way: the world that God loves just keeps getting bigger. The world that God loves just keeps getting bigger. But the official approaches Jesus in a little bit of a dire situation. I hope and I pray that I will never have to experience or understand the depths of this man's cry. To sprint more than 10 miles, to look at a man you've never met before and say, please come show up or my kid's gonna die. That's the situation that this royal official finds himself in. And Jesus' response is a little brash. It comes across a little brash. This is what Jesus says in verse 48 of chapter 4 in John. Jesus told him, unless you people see signs and wonders, you will not believe. Unless you people see signs and wonders, you will not believe. Some of your translations may say, unless you see signs and wonders, but this word you is in the plural tense. So this is less of an individual indictment of the royal official and his faith and more of a cultural commentary on what Jesus is seeing amongst the people around him. I think this can really influence our culture as well. We have become so infatuated with the signs and the wonders and the miraculous deeds of God that we've forgotten the foundation that causes all of those things to actually happen. God, show me your ability, show me what you do, and then I'll place my trust in you. We become really enamored with these visible signs, so much so that they've almost become a necessary prerequisite for us to place our trust in Jesus. Like we've probably all been in this moment where we're praying, oh Jesus, if you just do this, then I'll do this. Right? Those desperation prayers that we've all experienced as people. If you just show up in this way, then I'll never do this again, or I will do this. And what we're doing is we're creating this contingency to which God must conform in order to earn our trust. Leslie Newbegin puts it this way in his commentary on John. The demand for a visible sign means that the one who makes the demand keeps ultimate sovereignty in his own hands. He has himself prescribed the test by which divinity must prove itself. He has himself prescribed the test by which divinity must prove itself. We have to be careful to not just want what Jesus can do, but want who Jesus is. That's the commentary that Jesus is making. My wife and I are not car people. Like we do own them and we can turn them on and off. And outside of that, we are not car people. So in the past, if we've ever gone shopping for a car, we will FaceTime our brother-in-law to make sure that like the engine comes with it and it's there. But if that car has Apple CarPlay, I'm intrigued. Like, tell me more. I'm not sure if there's an alternator or a battery involved in this vehicle of any kind, but if it has heated seats, please tell me more, right? Like, and this is the kind of thing that Jesus is calling out. He's like, you want these bells and whistles without the foundational elements that actually makes the bells and whistles possible. Like, you just want that space. Unless you people see the signs and wonders, you're not gonna believe. It's what Jesus is saying to the people around him in this moment. But the royal official is persistent. Verse 49, he just cuts to the chase. Sir, the official said to him, come down before my boy dies. You cannot be any more direct with someone you think is a miracle worker than to say, this is what I need, please do it. Verse 50, go, Jesus told him, your son will live. And the man believed what Jesus said to him and departed. This is the space in the story where we see a beautiful picture of what faith in God looks like. He believes what Jesus says before he ever sees what Jesus does. He believes what Jesus says before he ever sees what Jesus does. There's a reason that Jesus would say later in the Gospel of John in chapter 20, blessed are those who have not seen and yet believe. The author of Hebrews puts it this way, faith is the reality of things hoped for and the proof of what is not seen. Faith and this element of unseen are always going to be inextricably linked. You can find examples all over Scripture, riddled throughout the Old Testament and the New Testament, of people acting on the promises of God before ever seeing the provision of God. One of my favorite examples, if you have your Bible with you this morning, flip over to Genesis chapter 12. It's a story of God interacting with Abram. If you're newer to walking with Jesus, Genesis is the very front of your Bible. Genesis chapter 12. So this is before he's even been renamed Abraham. This is before he's received a promised son. This is before he's been turned into a great nation, a multitude. This is before a lot of things that we know Abraham for. And he's 75 years young. And the future does not seem clear to him. And this is what the Lord says to him in Genesis chapter 12. How is this for instilling confidence for the direction you need to take your life? The Lord said to Abram, go from your land, your relatives, and your father's house to the land I will show you. I will make you into a great nation. I will bless you. I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you. I will curse anyone who treats you with contempt, and all the peoples on earth will be blessed through you. So Abraham went as the Lord told him. God makes six I will statements in the span of three verses. The word will is used eight times in three verses. If I look at my wife, Kim, and I say, babe, I will do the dishes. What is really easy for her to potentially hear if she wants to in that statement? That I have not yet done the dishes. Right? Now, she's very kind and trusts that when I say I will do them, I will actually follow through on that statement. But Abram's in this interesting predicament, this in-between space, where he has two opportunities, two ways that he can respond to God. First, he can say, this is the most vague thing I've ever heard from you. I'm 75. You have my heart. Just tell me what to do and I'll do it. Like, give me the directions clearly. He can say that. The second, simpler, but probably much harder route to go is simply to say, I trust who you are, so I'll trust what you say. Trust who you are, and I'll trust what you say. Abram ends up choosing the latter, and so does this royal official in John chapter 4. Caroline Lewis, speaking of the sign and the miracle in general, puts it this way in her great commentary. The royal official does not believe in Jesus because of the sign Jesus performs for him. Even though the sign is incredible, healing his son who is on the verge of death, he first takes Jesus at his word. While he will believe after the sign, as will his whole household, what he believes in that moment is not the sign itself, but that what Jesus says is true. So here's the picture we're seeing in this second sign in the Gospel of John. We're seeing that Jesus is using things that are tangible to prove things that are intangible. So he is using deeds, signs, and wonders to prove that his word holds weight, value, and is truthful. There's another example of this in Mark chapter 2, where a paralytic is lowered down, like a hole in the roof is cut out of this packed home. And a paralytic is lowered down by his four faithful friends and placed at the feet of Jesus. And Jesus looks at the young man and he forgives him of his sins. The scribes start looking at each other like, who is this guy that thinks he can do that? Jesus senses the grumbling, and in chapter 2, verse 9, he says this: which is easier, to say to the paralytic, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up, grab your pallet, and walk? But so that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins, he said to the paralytic, I say to you, get up, pick up your pallet, and go home. He got up and immediately picked up his pallet and went out in the sight of everyone. So they were all amazed and were glorifying God, saying, we have never seen anything like this. So what Jesus is doing is he is using the tangible expressions of his power to prove the symbolism that his words actually hold all of that weight. His words are what is actually powerful. He's conveying to us in the second sign in the Gospel of John that Jesus is Lord of life. That Jesus is Lord of life. Think of the very beginning of our story. In the beginning, God created and there was light. And here we see Jesus speak and there is life. He is showing you and me that he is the continuation and the fulfillment. The way Paul says it in his letter to the church in Corinth is that Jesus was the yes to every one of God's promises, and in him we have our amen. We are seeing that Jesus has the power. He is the Lord of all life, and that his words hold weight and that they're true. Have you noticed that in the first two signs we've studied, the first two of seven, two miracles have happened and Jesus has done nothing other than to speak. All he's done is speak. This is very intentional by design. He is laying the foundation and the framework that the first thing I want you to believe is that everything that I say is true. And I will prove it to you with these physical, tangible signs. But it's laying the framework and the foundation that his words hold truth and they hold value. And not only did he heal this son, but he healed him from a long distance. Distance from Cana to Capernaum is a little over 10 miles, depending on the route that you would take. And so he heals him from a distance to further emphasize the power of the words. You separate the tangible piece to further emphasize the intangible piece. We see the healing take place. It's not predicated on Jesus's presence, but on his promise. And that's what we see happen. There's one word in chapter 4, verse 52 that I don't want us to miss out on. Pay extra attention to. Not, it's so easy to skip past. So the official is headed home. Jesus has dismissed him. He's faithfully just gone and departed. He's heading home. His servants meet him along the way. And he looks at them and they say, your boy is alive. Like he's made it. He asks for confirmation. When did it happen? And the servant responds with yesterday at 1. This is 1 in the afternoon, 1 p.m., just afternoon. Yesterday at 1. The distance from Cana to Capernaum, a little over 10 miles, depending on your route. You could travel, most theologians think you could travel that in that day between 4 and 6 hours. So if your child is on their deathbed and you get dismissed with a promise from the presence of Jesus at 1 p.m., where are you going? I'm going straight home to see if the word I received is true. And what we can confidently infer from this passage is that that man didn't even go home that night. That's how much he believed that the word of Jesus for him in his life was true. We see a beautiful picture of the Lord's faithfulness to this man. So if Jesus is the Lord of life and his words are true, what does interacting with him actually look like? There's the beautiful moment in the end of the Samaritan woman's story in John 4 and the end of this royal official's story in John chapter 4 as well. Many people come to know Christ because of these individuals' faith. Many people come to know Christ because of these individuals' faith. Verse 53 reads, the father realized this was the very hour at which Jesus told him, your son will live. So he himself believed along with his entire household. Dietrich Bonhoeffer says that your life as a Christian should make non-believers question their disbelief in God. Your life as a Christian should make non-believers question their disbelief in God. So our expectancy of the Lord's presence, of his power, and of his movement should be at such a high level that people who do not know Jesus and have not interacted with Jesus, but see us look at Jesus, they should turn their gaze and look at this guy and say, it's unlike anything we've ever seen, like the ending of Mark 2. Kara Powell puts it this way, most of us learn to trust Jesus by first trusting someone else who trusts Jesus, right? Think about your personal faith story. For many of us in this room, we learned to trust Jesus because we saw other people trusting him well, other people fixing their gaze on him, living expectant lives. So let me be clear, this doesn't mean that someone's faith is contingent upon yours, but it can certainly be encouraged and spurred on by yours. If you are in this room and you're passionate about the next generation, I would also, having formerly been a high school pastor here, I would selfishly argue that if you're a believer in Jesus, it is actually all of our biblical responsibilities to steward and to shepherd the spirituality of the next generation. So I would say we should all be included in this call. If you're passionate about the next generation, if the next generation is being raised within your home, what would it look like for us to live in such an expectant way that the next generation is raised up and as adults, they look at us and they begin to question their disbelief in God? Not question why we do believe, but question their own disbelief in God. Can we live in such a fervent way as we interact with Jesus because we are so confident in who he is and what he said that other people can't help but turn and look at him too? I think it begins with adamant prayer. Richard Foster writes this, if we truly love people, we will desire for them far more than it is within our power to give them. That's so good. If we truly love people, we will desire for them far more than it is within our power to give them. And this will lead us to only prayer. Intercession is a way of loving others. An intercessory prayer is selfless prayer, even self-giving prayer. And in the ongoing work of the kingdom of God, nothing is more important than intercessory prayer. So we pray expectantly. We live expectantly, and we serve one another expectantly because we trust he is who he says he is, and he'll do what he'll say he'll do. In our expectant prayers, let's not allow our prayers to convince ourselves that God is not capable of doing immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine, according to Ephesians 3:20. Let's not dip our prayers to such a low level of expectancy that we're not giving God our trust in his capacity and ability. So we can approach the throne of grace with boldness, not because we understand the answers to every problem, but we can simply trust who he is and what he says. Pastor Tyler Statton says this, before we can have faith that God will answer a given request, we simply have to learn to trust the character of the God we're talking to. Jesus hasn't revealed a God we can perfectly understand, but he has revealed a God we can perfectly trust. Trust is the certainty that the listening God hears and cares. I trust that the God who, even when he doesn't make the suffering go away, wears the suffering alongside me. So the tightrope that we are charged with walking as believers is learning to balance this tension where we do live in a broken world that is affected by sin and hardship, and we also serve a God who is truly good, who is capable of doing immeasurably more than all we could ask or imagine. So the way that we approach God in those areas matters. It matters drastically. We can't necessarily approach God with this high expectancy, with high anticipation, with high hope, and then also attach our personal expectations of the timeline, of how, when, and why God should or shouldn't do anything. But we also can't flip it so far to the other side where we lower our hopefulness in God, our anticipation of who he is or what he's capable of, and then we don't put any expectations on it. It's actually not a holistic view of what faithfully approaching God may look like. So we can pray expectantly, but we pray without expectation, if that makes sense. We can approach the throne expectantly, but without holding tightly to our expectations and submitting the sovereignty and authority over to him. This royal official served under King Herod. King Herod in Jesus' day was the picture of power and authority. If the royal official wanted power, if he wanted authority, if he wanted wealth, he had it over in Herod, and yet he chose to go to Jesus. And I can't help but think, as that man told his family generations and all of his friends and anyone who would ever listen to him, of the faithfulness of Jesus in that moment, what I can't help but think, that son who was miraculously healed, what he saw was that his dad placed his expectancy in Jesus and not in Herod. So what would it look like, church, 15, 20 years from now? And whoever's a part of the next generation that the Lord has entrusted you to help disciple, to encourage, and to speak into, if they see that your fervent love was placed in Jesus and not your financial security, that your hope was placed in Jesus and not your job title, that your hope was placed in Jesus and not a political preference, Jesus and not your kids' athletic ability, what would this church look like? If 15 years from now, if 1 year from now, if a week from now, the next generation looks at us and what they see is people who are fixed on Jesus and who have a beautiful hope and anticipation in who he is, and a beautiful humility, recognizing that we can't hold the answers and we don't get to hold all of those, and we can walk in that tension healthily all the while pointing them to a God who loves them and cares deeply for them. I think our world would look different in the most beautiful way. I want to ask you a few questions to help us process together this morning. The first one is this: can we approach the throne with bold expectancy, but in humility submit our expectations? Is there one of those that you feel like you're already doing well in, one you could feel a little bit of encouragement in? For me, our life group met, this was probably years ago. Our life group was meeting. We were talking through the prayer of Jabez, where he like asks for literal blessing. And our life group was like, hey, everybody do that kind of for their family. And everybody raised their hand, except for me. And it took quite a few conversations, but I think what I realized was I was lowering in an effort of false humility to lay my expectation down at the feet of Jesus. I also wasn't being expectant of who he actually is and of what he's actually capable of doing. So that's the first question. Second question: can we trust Jesus' promise before we see his provision? Can we trust in Jesus' promise before we see his provision? Then the last question, maybe you're sitting in this weird in-between space, kind of like an Abram's story, where you have the promises of God, but you don't see the provision of God quite yet. So it's this I will, this waiting season. And one of the weird things about faith is it can actually cause you to rest really well, because it takes your gaze away from the provision that's either there or not there, and it just looks at a provider who's good. Helps you reframe that. So that last question, can I hear I will from the Lord and allow the rest to be up to him? Is there a story that you're in right now where that's your story? Can you have that same experience? Can you hear I will and say, okay, resting on the sure promises of God, that he is good, that he loves you. He will never leave you or forsake you. We trust Jesus because he's the Lord of life and his words are true. So we pray expectantly for big things to happen. We want to pray Ephesians 3:20 prayers. And Paul says in Ephesians 3:20, it's even bigger than what you know how to pray for, is what God can do. So we're going to pray those prayers, but we are also going to humbly submit the outcome to him and trust that he's good. I want to close our teaching time together with sharing with you John's original picture of who Jesus was. This is the expectancy that the Apostle John had in Jesus. Would you stand with me? John chapter 1, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were created through him, and apart from him, not one thing was created that's been created. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. That light shines in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. This is the Jesus that we serve. This is the Jesus that we love. So we will boldly pray big things and then humbly submit to his authority in our lives. Let's worship together.
Yours is the kingdom. Yours is the
Jesus, this morning, it is your power that we can stand upon. Regardless of what the circumstance looks like that we're facing, whether we've received provision, whether we feel like we're just sitting in the promise and we don't know what the provision actually looks like, we submit it to you because we know you are a God that with one word, anything can change. And we trust that you are that God, whether we see the change or not, whether the change makes happen, it happens and it makes sense or it doesn't. We just look to you and we trust you. God, we pray that the next generation would grow up seeing believers who are so fervent in their appreciation of just who you are, not what you've done, but just who you are, the goodness of your nature and your character. Would it be so palpable that people who are far from you would begin to question their disbelief in you if we truly believe that we have the best news in the history of humankind? It should change everything. So God, we walk forward with hope. We walk forward with anticipation of who you are and what you're capable of doing, and we hold the results open-handed and entrust them to you. We love you, Lord. It's in your name that we said together this morning. Amen. Church, it's so good to be worshiping with you today. It's so good. Yes. If you are brand new and want to know what your next step is here at Bentry, you can walk out these doors and then over to your left to our guest reception. We'd love to meet you there. And if you want to join 138 other people who have signed up to have lunch with us today in the family theater, please do so. You can just show up. You can have my lunch, okay? We love you, church. We can't wait to continue worshiping with you. We'll see you next week. Let's go. All right. That's on your feet.
What a great service. It was so fun to get to worship together. And then to open God's word, to see this incredible sign that Jesus performed as he cared for this man, as he came to him saying, "My son is dying. Would you do something?" And Jesus did. And we continue to believe that he still does miracles. He still is functioning in this world to save and redeem and to heal. And he's always bringing hope. And we hope that you were encouraged. And wherever you are in your life, what you've been experiencing, maybe today is a day to sit with him a little bit and ask the Spirit to speak into your thoughts, to reveal the places where you are uncertain that he even cares, that he might be able to convince you of his care for you, his love for you, that you are seen and heard and loved. If you'd like to connect with one of our pastors, we would love to connect with you. Please email us at pastors@benttree.org. We would love to hear your story and to be able to pray for you and to pray with you. I'm so thankful that you would choose to spend this part of your day with us. If you are near our Carrollton campus and would like to learn more about serving in any of the ministries that we have at Bentree, you are more than welcome to join us at the lunch after the second hour. If you're interested in learning more about just serving online, and maybe that's the best space for you, please email me at online@benttree.org. I would love to connect and to share with you the opportunities that are there. I'm thankful for you. I'm praying for you and can't wait for us to get to worship together next week. We'll see you then. Just try.
is desperate.